थैंक यू मैडम.
थैंक यू वेरी मच रिस्पेक्टेड सीनियर्स चेयरपर्सन्स colleagues. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers, Dr. Anuj Maheshwari sir, Dr. Jayant Panda, and the entire team of ACP India chapter for giving me this wonderful opportunity to talk on this very important topic and to give me this podium to be present on this very important podium. So I'll be talking on a very primary basic topic, and that will be diagnosis made easy, interpretation of thyroid function tests. So, as we know that the regulation of the thyroid axis involves the hypothalamus, pituitary, and thyroid, and the entire hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis is responsible for the equilibrium of thyroid hormones and the function which we have, which affects the so many metabolism and so many important functions that the thyroid hormones have on the entire body, and that is response, and that is what we test when we do the thyroid function test. So we have so many tests. Why we talk so much specifically of interpretation of thyroid function tests? That is the question. So what is the significance? So although thyroid disease in its most florid form is easily recognized, it's a very common disorder. We know that affecting to as much as 2 to 10% of the entire population. And it's easily recognized, but still we see that patients often manifest with symptoms or signs that are many a times non-specific. Many a times they present to clinicians of different specialties. They may go to a gynecologist, they may go to a skin specialist, they may go to a psychiatrist. So we have so many, even in orthopedic surgeons, so many different manifestations and specialties. And accordingly, we need a high clinical index of suspicion to confirm the diagnosis. And this requires a very accurate measurement and interpretation of the thyroid function test. And then, as we know that there are some very commonly encountered patterns of abnormal thyroid function, so which we can say as the anomalous or discordant TFTs. Because when we have a thyroid function test, we make a clinical diagnosis. On the basis of the diagnosis, we order a thyroid function test. And sometimes when it comes totally discordant to the diagnosis that we suspect, then that becomes difficult to make out. And that is what I will be discussing in my talk today. So assessment of thyroid status basically assesses the status of the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis, estimates the thyroid concentration in serum tests, the test for presence of autoimmune diseases, tests that provide information about the thyroid iodine metabolism and assessment of thyroid swellings. But as per the scope and the time for this talk, I will be discussing only for the first two, focusing on them. So when we talk about the thyroid function tests, the thyroid hormones, thyroxine, that is T4, and the triiodothyronine T3, these levels remain relatively constant and reflect the set point of the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. This is what we should remember, that the thyroid hormones remain relatively quite constant and reflect that set point. So if they change a little bit also, then the patient is rendered probably sometimes a little hypo and hyperthyroid, but they remain stable. But along with the changes which are there in the thyroid hormone, there's a concordant changes in the TSH levels. So if we talk about the thyroid hormones, that is the T3 and T4, what happens is that the reference ranges of these thyroid hormones are relatively quite wide. If we see how much change they go through, the reference ranges are quite wide. So suppose there is a minor change in the thyroid hormone level, it is sufficient to render a person hyperthyroid or hypothyroid. But still, numerically, it will remain in the normal reference range. And that is the reason we are not able to diagnose on the basis of only T3, T4 many a times, which we call a subclinical or a mild disease. That the reference ranges being, it relies numerically in that range, but the change is sufficient. Suppose the T4 goes up, it is sufficient for the person to become hyperthyroid. But still, when we see in the reference range, it is within it. What changes? The TSH changes. So the excursion, even a modest change in the thyroid hormone, is associated with marked excursions of the TSH. And that is why TSH is traditionally recommended as a screening test for thyroid dysfunction. Having said all this, we still know that screening exclusively with TSH means that some patients will be misdiagnosed and will be missed altogether. So that alone is also not possible, though TSH is the traditional screening test and it is definitely a very important test in most cases. So which are the conditions in which alone TSH can be misleading? There can be central hypothyroidism. We know the secondary and the tertiary hypothyroidism, where the TSH does not change. The non-thyroidal illness, this is a very important set of disorders where the non-thyroidal illness leads to different changes, and then alone TSH gives a wrong interpretation. The recent treatment for thyrotoxicosis. Now this becomes very important, because when a person with thyrotoxicosis begins his treatment for a long period, it is only the thyroid hormones which give you a valid interpretation as to the change which is occurring. The TSH remains as such for a long time. So we should not be following up the patient with TSH, but instead the thyroid hormones. And resistance, the last two are relatively quite uncommon. Resistance, after excluding the upper three, we can think of the other two, that is a resistance to thyroid hormone and the TSH secreting TSHomas from the pituitary. So as we know, the test for the hypothalamo-pituitary thyroid axis, TSH is an important test, is a sensitive indicator, and it is an important screening test for most of the cases. We have ultra-sensitive fourth-generation assays existing, and which can detect as low as 0.004 milliunit per liter. So very sensitive assays. Even in the previous years, some two decades back, we used to rely more on the thyroid hormone and not on TSH. But now, with the availability of such advanced assays, even for hyperthyroidism, TSH becomes a valid indicator. We have various tests, the ELISA radioimmune assay, the chemiluminescent assay, and the fluorescent immune assay, out of which CLIA being the most preferred in most options, and mostly it is being used. T4 and T3 concentrations, we have to evaluate. The free hormones, also we have to evaluate. We should remember that thyroid hormone has a very, very significant protein binding. The major part is bound. So sometimes when the binding proteins, that is the thyroid binding globulin, the transthyretin and the albumin, if there are changes in these, then that leads to changes in the total thyroid hormone levels. And these are the conditions where we require to evaluate the free hormones more. So we can have so many permutation combinations where the thyroid hormone levels and the TSH levels are altered, and the various conditions we'll be discussing. So what are the various TFT patterns? This is the commonest pattern that we see, the high TSH and the low FT4. This suggests a primary hypothyroidism, most common. We all know this very well, the auto causes of this: autoimmune thyroiditis, post-radioiodine thyroidectomy, hypothyroid of phase of subacute thyroiditis. That is, initially we know there's a thyrotoxic phase in the hypothyroid phase and then the euthyroid phase in subacute thyroiditis. So the second phase, we can say. Drugs, amiodarone, lithium, tyrosine kinase inhibitors, they have a tendency to suppress the thyroid function. So they lead to hypothyroidism, the antithyroid drugs, of course. Iodine deficiency of excess by the Jordan-Weissmuller phenomenon and the Wilf-Chekhov effect. Neck irradiation, Riedel's thyroiditis, thyroid infiltration, and congenital hypothyroidism. Now, this is an important set which we know, high TSH in normal thyroid hormones. So this is an important group. We know that subclinical hypothyroidism, when the TSH goes high, but the thyroid hormones are still within the normal range, as we just discussed, the subclinical, which was to be called the mild hypothyroidism, we should go in for anti-TPO antibodies, which help us in decision-making as to what we should do, whether we should institute therapy or not. Confirmation is advised. However, in certain circumstances, for example, in pregnancy or where a pregnancy is being planned, replacement should be instituted without delay. But only subclinical hypothyroidism is not the condition which leads to such picture. We should always remember, probably we attribute to subclinical hypothyroidism in most cases. We should remember there is an assay interference which could lead to such picture. And the second most important point which is there is that in patients where exogenous thyroxine is being given, it may reflect malabsorption, altered metabolism, or poor compliance. This is very important, because sometimes a patient is taking levothyroxine and the patient is probably not so compliant, and we get this picture, we keep on increasing the dose of thyroxine, which is probably not very correct. So that now we go to another picture where the thyroid TSH is high or within the normal range, whereas the thyroid hormones are high. This is a picture is not very frequently encountered. This can occur with assay interference of FDH, thyroxine replacement therapy, including poor compliance, drugs, non-thyroid illness, neonatal period where the TSH tends to remain high. The TSH very rarely, as I said, TSHomas and resistance to thyroid hormones and metabolism and transport of thyroid hormone disorders. So we should try to exclude the first four rather, and then the last three are relatively unusual. Low TSH and high thyroid hormones is a very common picture, as we know primary hyperthyroidism, Graves' disease, toxic multinodular goiter, toxic adenoma, thyroiditis, drugs, amiodarone, excess thyroxine ingestion, excess iodine intake, congenital hyperthyroidism, pregnancy-related thyrotoxicosis. Again, this is a simple setup which most of us can diagnose very well. Now, TSH reduced and thyroid hormones being in the normal range. This is again very important. This is a subclinical hyperthyroidism. Now, subclinical hyperthyroidism is again an important entity, because here we find that the thyroid hormones are okay. The TSH is mildly low. And there is a TSH suppression. Now, this group becomes important because there is an evidence, significant evidence, especially in the current times, that there is adverse sequel of atrial fibrillation, especially cardiovascular and osteoporosis, if TSH remains suppressed in the long term, especially in women, postmenopausal women and older than 65 years of age. Most patients more than 60. Here, this is an important set. And there is emerging evidence that individuals will have greater morbidity in the longer term. So however, having said this, that there is an increased morbidity, cardiovascular as well as other all-cause morbidity, increased chances of heart failure. Many a times, these subnormal TSH values tend to return back to normal on follow-up without intervention. So we should keep this in mind. And the non-thyroidal illness, another important entity, again leads to similar picture, which resolves on its own. So we should not go by a single TSH report, but we should try to have a confirmation which will give us more idea whether we should start management or not. TSH being low or normal and the thyroid hormones being low, this is simple. This is occurring in central hypothyroidism, non-thyroid illness, TSH deficiency, assay interference. So this is the usual cause of secondary or tertiary hypothyroidism. Now, having seen these basic TFT patterns, let's see some specific considerations. Now, this becomes important because when we are assessing the thyroid status, we should remember that the thyroid function test should confirm one's clinical suspicion. We should not look at the test individually. However, they should be aiding us in our clinical scenario. So if it is discordant with our clinical status, the reassessment if unexpected TFT result is there. Another important thing is when the patient is on levothyroxine therapy. When the patient is on levothyroxine therapy, anomalous or discordant TFTs are not infrequently seen in patients with levothyroxine therapy due to several causes. Some of the causes which I have mentioned here are very important, and very commonly we see that we are giving a good amount of levothyroxine, still the thyroid function has not come under control. And we keep on increasing the dose, and that probably does more harm because we have to rule out the various factors which could have been responsible for this factor. One is a normal variant, and normally many a people, it happens that the TSH remains normal for whatever amount of levothyroxine that we are giving. The TSH is okay, but the thyroid hormones remains a little on the higher side. But the patient feels comfortable and the patient is clinically good. So we have to see the clinical status of the patient. If that is so, this is a normal variant. Let the thyroxine dose be the same. Another is inappropriate administration. When we say that the patient does not take properly on an empty stomach, takes concurrent medications, probably this comes under the picture that the TSH persistently remains high. Malabsorption, another very important problem where the patient is taking a good amount, high dose you are giving, and still the TSH is remaining high. Try to rule this out. Increased thyroid hormone metabolism excretion, probably not very common, again has a similar picture that we just mentioned. Increased thyroid hormone binding capacity, as I said, that in oral estrogen therapy, the lot of thyroxine gets bound. So we need to have the TSH persistently remains high. Change in thyroxine preparation. This is something very important because we change the preparation, the bioavailability varies, and then the thyroid function tests go haywire. Assay interference, another very important factor to be kept in mind. And the second point, the most important factor I would say is the poor compliance. Patient takes regularly, then misses for 3-4 days. Again, the entire scenario goes haywire. And then what we get is we do not get a very good thyroid function test. And when we just apply increasing the dose, we increase the dose. After 3 months, what we see, the TSH is very low. And we don't realize why there are so many fluctuations. Probably this is the cause. Very unusually, resistance to TSH, because resistance to the thyroid hormones, because at the level of the thyroid hormone receptor, beta gene, there is a mutation. This is a very unusual and rare condition. Many a times, medications cause a lot of interferences in the measurement also, in the thyroid function also. This has to be kept in mind. Many a times, we have to also consider the hypothalamic pituitary diseases. If we suspect a central cause for the hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism, then TSH should not be considered as a reliable marker, especially for secondary or tertiary hypothyroidism. It is the free thyroid hormones which should be used to guide our management. Non-thyroidal illness, sick urothyroid syndrome, very important cause. Intercurrent illness can affect thyroid function in several ways. So commonly TSH is low, normal, or partially suppressed with low or normal free TSH. So we should try to avoid testing for thyroid hormones when the patient has other intercurrent illness or reconfirm after the patient recovers. What happens in sick urothyroid syndrome? There is a decrease in the activity of D1, D2, which usually convert the T4 to T3 in the periphery. And then there's a conversion, there's an increase in the activity of D3 enzyme, which converts free T3 to reverse T3, leading to an increase in reverse T3. And that leads to a reduction in the TSH. So it leads to a variety of combinations, and these various patterns we can find out, which are very confusing. Avoid relying on them, reconfirm when the patient is improved. Pregnancy alterations are very important. So trimester specific reference ranges should be used whenever possible. Assay interference is very important to be kept in mind. If the discordant TFTs are not explained by any of the factors that I just mentioned, we should remember there is something called assay interference, and that is important because simply sending a sample to another lab does not mean that you will get a better result, because different assay platforms also have similar interference. So we have to have a specialist advice and specialist lab where we have to discuss and accordingly try to see. Now I just review very rapidly about the other tests. The plasma thyroid hormone binding protein I just talked about, and the various conditions which increase or decrease the bindings can cause an alteration in the total and thyroid hormones. And so it's preferable in these conditions to go in for the free thyroid hormone levels. Serum thyroglobulin test usually used for follow-up of thyroid cancer patients. Thyroid autoantibodies, they are polyclonal antibodies, and they are increased in Hashimoto's thyroiditis and Graves disease. And there are various tests for thyroid antibodies. Then there are tests for thyroid iodine metabolism tests, the radioactive iodine uptake, and the thyroid scans, which are the technetium scan being the most preferred because it takes much shorter time, with the half-life being least. We use it for uptakes in patients where we consider where we're evaluating for masses, where we're evaluating for thyrotoxicosis. This is a hot nodule, as you can see. On one side, we have a normal scan. The other side, we see the hot nodule. Very importantly, we have to differentiate from subacute thyroiditis. You can see there is absolutely zero uptake in that. So I just put in a figure for that. Just a picture. Thyroid ultrasound is another Thyroid ultrasound is another important test, and so is thyroid FNAC, especially for masses. So summarizing, the results of thyroid function test must always be interpreted in the light of the clinical status of the patient. Awareness of the conditions or disorders that can be associated with different patterns guide further investigation and management. Confounding factors should always be kept into mind, like intercurrent non-thyroid illness or medications, before we just go in for bargain for a long list of biochemical, radiological, or genetic testings. And screening of thyroid for interference in thyroid hormone assays should also be kept in mind, and referral to specialists and endocrine service required whenever we have discordant TFTs. Concluding, a structured approach careful clinical assessment, judicious use of TFTs, knowledge of the adventitious disorders associated with different TFT patterns enables most TFTs to be reliably interpreted with avoidance of inappropriate investigations and treatment. Thank you.